city of state, and we were in the middle of a discussion about free electron gas. So we had calculated also before the momentum and the Fermi energy for the free electron gas in 1, 2, and 3 dimensions. So now, today we will see the, we will calculate the total energy using the density of state that we evaluated last time. So today we will calculate the energy of the electron gas. And we will do that using the density of state that we evaluated last time.
Are you recording? Mm-hmm. Are you recording?
Yes. Okay. I believe so, yes. Okay, so the total energy per unit cell. What's the quantity we want? So we have seen that we can evaluate it as an integral over the density of state times we want the average energy, so the quantity we are measuring is epsilon. And I put a factor here too because of the spin up and spin down, the spin degeneracy, I mean the degenerate case for a given psi epsilon with function, and then I integrate up to the Fermi energy. So the band starts at epsilon equal to 0, and I integrate up to the Fermi energy, and this is giving me the average energy per unit cell. All right, so and, I'm going to do it for the case of one electron per unit cell, which, as I mentioned earlier, the system that have one valence electron per unit cell are appropriate for this approximation. This is a good case to use the free electron gas model. So let's start from one dimension. So in the one dimensional case, we have seen that the density of state, D of epsilon, this I'm taking from last time, is A over pi times square root of m over 2h bar square times 1 over the square root of epsilon. You can check that this is what we had for the one-dimensional case. Okay, so now I'm going to calculate the average energy from that. So E is equal to the integral up to the Fermi energy of the epsilon, and I use this A over pi square root of m over 2h bar square, and then I have this 1 over the square root of epsilon, which comes from the density of state, and then I need to put this as I'm evaluating the average energy. And that's what I need to evaluate. So this is equal, I will be able to simplify here and obtain a square root of epsilon times some constant and the primitive of the epsilon to the power 1/2 is 3/2 epsilon to the power, 2/3 epsilon to the power 3/2. So I will write the factors here. So it's A over pi square root of m over 2h bar square, and I have my 2, and then, as I mentioned, the primitive will be epsilon to the power 3/2, and I need a factor 2/3 in front, and since it's non-zero only on the upper bound there, it's going to be epsilon f to the power 3/2. Okay, so this is the result given in terms of epsilon, but we have seen also before that epsilon, we can write it in terms of the electronic density or in terms of 1 over a square in 1 over a in terms of the density. So epsilon f, we had also seen that this is pi over 8, pi square over 8, h bar square over n, 1 over a square. This is what we had seen before, and this is the electronic density to the power 2. In one dimension, we have the Fermi energy, and that is proportional to the density to the power. So I will use that to continue here. And if I replace epsilon f by this quantity, I'm going to have a over pi times square root of n over 2h bar square times 4 over 3. And then this to the power 3/2, so it's pi to the power 3. This I can write as 2 square root of 2 to the power 3. Just took the square root of 8 there. And then I have h bar square over m to the power 3/2. And 1 over a square. This is what I obtain when I replace.
Square or cube, yeah.
Cube, you're right. A to the power 3. Okay? All right. So actually, if I simplify a bit, when I'm right, I'm going to get 1/3, and then pi to the power 2 over 8. The pi is indeed correct, and then the 8, you can get it. H bar square over m times a 1 over a square this time. Okay? Well, okay, that's the result. And if you look, you compare this and this, you get that this is equal to 1/3 the Fermi energy. Okay?
Yeah.
So, in one dimension, we have that the average energy per unit cell in the case of the free electron gas is 1/3 the Fermi energy. And if I had used the density, the general result would be 1/3 the number of electrons per unit cell times the Fermi energy. Here I used one electron per unit cell, but most generally it would be this. Okay, now let's see the three-dimensional case. We'll come back to the two-dimensional afterwards. We have new chalk, but it's difficult to erase. Okay, so now I'm going to the 3D case. So in the 3D case, we had the density of state, D of epsilon, which was equal to A to the power 3, 2 pi square, 2 m over h bar square, 3/2 times square root of epsilon. So you should remember that it goes like the square root of epsilon and the factor you can check from your notes. So this is the density of state in three dimensions for the free electron gas. So the average energy in this case is this integral from 0 to epsilon Fermi, the epsilon times A cube over 2 pi to the power 2, 2m over h bar square to the power 3/2 times square root of epsilon, and when I evaluate epsilon times 2 to get the average energy multiplied by that. Okay, so in this case I'm obtaining as factor A cube over 2 pi square times 2m over h bar square to the power 3/2 times. Now I'm going to have the factor 2 here, and then I have epsilon to the power 3/2, and the primitive is epsilon to the power 5/2, and I need then a factor 2/5 in front, and this is the result. Okay, right now I'm using again the expression of the Fermi energy for the three-dimensional case. So in three dimension I had epsilon Fermi is equal to 1/2 3 over pi 2/3 times pi square times h bar square over m times 1 over a square. This is what we had. And yeah, this is the density to the power 2/3 if I replace in general. Okay, so now we'll do the same thing in one dimension. I will replace epsilon Fermi by that. Okay. I'm continuing here. The this integration and the average energy is equal to a cube over 2 pi square times 2m over h bar square, and I have power 3 half, then I have 4 fifths, and then I'm putting my Fermi energy to the power 5 half. So I'm getting 1 half to the power 5 half, 3 over pi to the power 5 half, no, 5 third. Because I had 2 thirds, and then I have pi to the power 5, and then h bar square over m to the power 5 half, and 1 over a to the power 5. Okay. Alright, and now I know that I need the factor times the Fermi energy, so I'm putting the 3 in front from the 5 third, I take 3 third, and I have this factor, 3 fifths. I take also 1 half from the 5 half, I take 2 halves, and then I'm getting here 3 over pi to the power 2 third times pi to the power 2 and h bar square over m times 1 over a square. That's what we get. Rewriting and simplifying. And this, if you compare to the Fermi energy here, is 3 fifths the Fermi energy. And in the general case, it would be 3/5 the number of electron per unit cell times the Fermi energy. So we now we can guess. Summarize. So in one dimension we had the density of state d of epsilon that was going like 1 over the square root of the energy, so a function like this. We had the Fermi energy here. And in one dimension, we found that the average energy was 1 third of the Fermi energy, so was around here. Which makes sense. There is a strong weight here. If you average in this interval, you are going to get something on this side of the axis. So this is what we obtained in one dimension. Now in three dimension, the density of state was going like the square root of the energy. So we have something that goes like this. The density of state, the Fermi energy, seems here. And in this case, we were finding 3/5 of the Fermi energy, which also makes sense. We have something more on this side of the curve. So that makes sense. Now, wild guess. The density of state in two dimensions for the free electron gas, we have seen that it is a constant. So I have my Fermi energy. So what is your guess for the average energy?
Half of Fermi.
One.
One half,
yes. So in the case of the two dimensions, we will have for one electron this, and in general we will have this for the average density, the average energy. So I would like to, as an exercise for next time, to check this just analytically with the density, with the number of electrons. Also. Okay, so, yes. We have this for these three cases, for the free electron gas. Okay, so that is what I wanted to show so far on the free electron gas. And now we are going to introduce the temperature, because so far we have discussed everything at zero temperature. And now we would like to see how things should be generalized when one has final temperature, and we are interested at room temperature, 300 Kelvin. Okay, so what will change with temperature is the occupation number. So, occupation number which we have written as F of epsilon, and we want to discuss the temperature dependence. So, if I had classical particle, the distribution would be of that type. It would be proportional to exponential of minus epsilon, the energy, over K Boltzmann times the temperature. So for classical particles, we would have a Boltzmann distribution, Boltzmann statistics. Now, of course, we are discussing electrons, so which statistic should we use? So, for fermion, we need to use the Fermi Dirac distribution. So we need to use f of epsilon is equal, so the distribution is 1 over exponential epsilon minus epsilon f divided by k Boltzmann t plus 1. And I've put a factor 2 here because of the way I define my occupation number. So the 2 is for the spin degeneracy. So this is the Fermi Dirac distribution. And when I consider particle with a very high energy epsilon, I recover the classical Boltzmann distribution. So for energy becoming very large, my occupation number f of epsilon becomes thanks to exponential minus epsilon over k Boltzmann t goes back to the Boltzmann distribution. So when the energy becomes very large, one goes exponentially to zero and recovers Boltzmann. All right, so let's draw it. Let me check the occupation number. So I want, as a function of the energy, epsilon, the occupation number, f of epsilon. I indicate here my Fermi energy, epsilon Fermi. So if I evaluate my function at the Fermi energy, I obtain an exponential to the power 0, so 1 here, and I'm obtaining a factor 1/2 here, and with the 2. So if here I have 2, at the Fermi energy I have 1/2 of that quantity. Then I know that when the energy goes to becomes large, goes away from the Fermi energy, is larger than the Fermi energy, it goes exponentially to zero. So here I will have an exponential behavior to zero. Now, when my energy is very negative, here this is going to tend to zero, and I will have just the so here I will have 1, and I have my factor 2. So for negative energy here, I will just remain with my factor 2, and when I'm far from the Fermian, and I will just have a constant 2. And if I look more carefully from the Fermi energy, when I go, I'm a bit smaller than the Fermi energy, I will actually also tend exponentially to the constant 2 here. So I will have 2, and here I'm tending exponentially to this constant, and here I'm tending exponentially to 0. Okay? So this is how the Fermi-Dirac distribution looks. And actually, the place where it differs from a constant, either 0 or either 2, or within, extremely close to 2 or extremely close to 0, the region where it differs from these two values here is a window around the Fermi energy that has a width of the order of k, well, of about k Boltzmann t. So the Fermi-Dirac distribution is almost always a constant, either 0 or 2, except in a small window. I mean, it goes exponentially to these two values, so it is the difference with respect to this value goes decrease exponentially, and it's almost that value if one is outside this window. Okay? So this is the Fermi-Dirac. The occupation number with which we have to deal. And we are interested in a temperature here, which is room temperature, so 300 Kelvin. And if we evaluate this k Boltzmann T at room temperature, for T equal room temperature, this is around 25 milliV. So this is at room temperature. So meaning 300 Kelvin. So this is extremely small comparing to the band structure. I mean, the typical width of a band in semiconductors or in metals, it's even larger, is of the order of 1 to 10 mV. So this is at least 2 orders of magnitude smaller than a typical width of band. So it's extremely small. So this is very small compared to the bandwidths, typical bandwidths, electronic bandwidths. Okay, which is typically of the order of 1 to 10 bandwidths. So for most quantities, average quantities, one can consider basically that the Fermi-Dirac, the occupation number is a step function, because of course, if I take the limit where the temperature goes to 0, the function here will tend to a step function. So this is the limit where t goes to 0, one tends to the step function. So In most cases, for most quantity, well, for the quantities, if one just wants some average quantity, then one can use the step function at room temperature. So the step function, which is the limit log when where t goes to zero, is a good approximation. At room temperature, in general, but not always, and the exception is when one wants to evaluate some quantity which is a derivative with respect to the temperature. Then it's a bit more delicate. For average values, it's okay, but for when one starts to investigate derivative with respect to temperature, then it is a bit more delicate. So approximation at room temperature, and put it wrong. At room temperature. So this is correct. It is a good approximation in general, but not always. And the exception is when one wants to take derivatives with respect to temperature, except when one takes the derivative and a typical example is the heat capacity CV, which is the derivative of the average energy with respect to temperature. So the heat capacity discussing the electronic part using the occupation number. So the heat capacity of a metal, for instance. And we are discussing, this is for the electronic part. So to evaluate that, it's not good to take just a step function. It's not enough to get the correct result or the correct dependence on the temperature. So heat capacity or specific heat of a metal. So in that case, the average energy so we consider this time most generally a metal. So I'm integrating from minus infinity to plus infinity the energy over the energy, and I want the average energy. I need the density of state and the occupation number. So this gives me the average energy in general. I have a given band structure which gives me the density of state, and I have to evaluate this, and the temperature enters here through the occupation number. The density of state or the band structure has almost negligible dependence on the temperature. The dominant term here is the occupation number.
Sorry.
Yes.
If at room temperature the Fermi Dirac distribution is can be approximated with step function, can the derivative be approximated with Dirac delta with a minus sign? if we want to calculate the heat capacity?
No. It's not enough.
Okay.
All right. So now let me draw a bit things. So maybe I will need a bit more. All right. So let's consider a Venn structure. Epsilon, and I have my density of state here, and below I have the occupation numbers F of epsilon, and I have my Fermi energy here, epsilon Fermi. So I have my final temperature. So this is the occupation number. Well, I know it should be half here, so it's actually very symmetric. So this is my occupation number at final temperature. So as I mentioned, I need just to consider a small window around the Fermi energy whose width is kT. And it's the only place where my occupation number will differ from a constant. So basically in this region, the derivative with respect to temperature will be zero. Here it will also be zero. And the only place where it will differ is in this window. And then I have a bend. Will be like this. But I exaggerated here. I know that this is essentially two orders of magnitude smaller than the bandwidth. So it's extremely small, actually. I should. You understood. Basically, this window is tiny compared to my band. So, the derivative with respect to the temperature will differ only in a small, in this window. Everywhere else it will be zero. So df over dt, which is the only term where I have to derive here, will be significant only around the Fermi energy. Around the Fermi energy and within a window, within the region kT. That's the only place where it's going to differ basically from zero. Now I want to give you the dependence on the temperature of the heat capacity. And I'm going to do it a bit in a hand-waving way, but the result is correct. And the hand-waving argument is also sound. So I'm not going to derive it mathematically precisely, but in a more hand-waving way. But when one needs to get the orders of the dependence on KT, this type of argument is sound, works. So, well, the first thing is, it's quite obvious, if this is tiny, tiny compared to my curve, my band structure, I can approximate in this evaluation the density of state in this window as a constant, as the value of the density of state at the Fermi energy. So to the lowest order in KT, the lowest order in KT, I can approximate my density of state in the only place where this integral doesn't give zero, I can approximate it as d of epsilon Fermi, that's the value of the Fermi energy. This is quite obvious considering orders of magnitude. I mean, that this is essentially 25 mEV. I mean, I'm focusing on room temperature. All right, so now I will evaluate my from final difference. So for small temperature T, my CV, heat capacity, I can write it as the energy, the average energy at the temperature T minus the average energy for T going to zero, which corresponds to the evaluation with the step function of the average energy, divided by the temperature. So, when the temperature T increases with respect to T equal to zero, I will have a decreasing occupation of the electronic states which are below the Fermi energy and an increasing occupation of those above the Fermi energy. So, if I compare the situation T equal to zero, which is the step function, with the temperature pi max T, which is what I have drawn, so the temperature T equal to zero will correspond to the step function here, and I'm at final temperature T, so I'm having the red curve here. So what will happen is that the electrons which, there is a fraction of electron here in red which will be emptied, and a fraction of electrons here which will be filled. I will have a depletion of electrons below the Fermi energy and an occupation, electronic occupation above the Fermi energy. And the amount is this surface. So this is what will be removed and this is what will be added in terms of occupation of electrons. Okay, So when T increases, when t increases from zero, I will have a decrease in the occupation. In the occupation of electronic states, just below epsilon Fermi, and an increase in the occupation. Just above. Epsilon for me. And this part here it's essentially a measure of the gain in the total energy due to this excitation, that is, this electron moving up in energy here. So here what I'm measuring with respect to the case, reference case, that is the step function, is a gain in the total energy due to excited electron. It is the reason my total energy here will change is because of this displacement, that is, I'm emptying states below the Fermi energy, and I'm occupying state above the Fermi energy. And the density of states of these states is a constant. So I measure here exactly the the changes just from the f of t. So what I will have is that I will have a number of transferred electrons which will be proportional to kT. I mean, the number of electrons that are going to be emptied, the number of excited electrons is going to be this red surface. That is, I empty this part, I fill this part, so the number of excited electrons will be just this integral here in red. So it's going to be proportional to kT. And then I have the average energy. And this energy here, I will also basically increase my energy by kT from an average value which is here to an average value which is here. So also the energy gained per electron will be proportional to kT. Okay? That is basically what I'm measuring. The density of state, I can take it out of the integral. And I'm measuring the average energy with this function here, where here I have a negative sign, and here I will have a positive sign, because everything is referenced with respect to the step function. So when I will integrate here, basically I will have an excitation of electrons from here to here, and the number is proportional to kT. And I have also an average energy will be, which will change by about that amount, that is from here to here. It's also going to increase like KT. So basically, from there, I guess I can obtain the order of the change in KT, that is this increasing energy or gain in total energy to, due to this excitation will be proportional to the number of transferred electrons times the energy gained per electrons. So it's going to be proportional to KT squared. Okay? It's a quadratic thing because the the energy will change as KT from here to here, and the number of electrons is also proportional to KT, the number of excited electrons. I mean, this just measures the gain in the total energy to, due to this excited electron. And, well, from the drawing, one can guess that this, I mean, the order in KT, in the sense, it should be the product of these two things, and therefore it must go like KT squared. And then I have to divide by T to get the, this final difference derivative. And therefore, in the end, I will obtain that the CV, the heat capacity, is proportional to the temperature, cube temperature. So this is what comes out basically from the Fermi-Dirac distribution, that the part of the heat capacity due to the electron grows like the temperature, which is different from the classical behavior from the Boltzmann. One would have a constant, and actually for boson, which has the Bose-Einstein distribution, which is a third distribution, one would have also a different T dependence. It would go like T cube. So this behavior is really coming from quantum mechanics, the fermionic nature of the electrons. This gives the CV going like T. Well, it was hand waving, but it's correct. That is, the, one can do it more mathematically, but the result will be this. And hand wavingly, this is the reason why it goes like T. All right. So this is the part. So this was to show you that in some cases one can, one cannot really take it as a step function, but it's very special cases. Obviously, if one takes the derivative with respect to temperature in this region, it's going to change quite a bit. So that is the exception. And in the case of the specific heat, going beyond the step function, one finds that the heat capacity grows like the temperature for the electron. Okay, so that is what I wanted to show you concerning the temperature dependence of the occupation number. Any question? Is it sort of clear? Okay. All right, so in the last part of this lecture, I will now define insulator, semiconductor, and discuss these systems. So let's... can I erase this? So the next part is on insulator and semiconductor. Versus semiconductor. To draw things. Okay, so let's consider a system with an even number of electrons, and we will assume that in this system the bands are well separated in energy. So I have a system, I'm looking at the green, this is the green zone, inside the green zone, and I will have some bands. And I'm assuming they are well separated in energy, like this. And let's say with my, so I have an even number of electrons per cell. And assuming when I fill my band, I fill up to here. That is, okay, let's say I have just two bands and I would have four electrons that would give me a filling up to here. Here I will consider that I have a quite large distance in energy between the highest occupied state and the lowest empty state. So this is the gap EG. And if I draw the density of state, so I'm looking at the energy here, and here I'm drawing the density of state, D of epsilon. So I will have one band here, it's density of state, another band here, and a third one here, this one is a bit. And I consider that these bands are filled, and the upper one is empty. And okay, now if I draw, if I consider the zero temperature case, then for my occupation number here, F of epsilon, at T equals zero, I can have my step function that stops anywhere I want in the band gap of this structure. I will obtain the correct result. I have a choice on where I want to put epsilon Fermi in principle for the step function, because any position would give me the correct number of electrons at zero temperature. So at t equal to zero, in principle, epsilon Fermi could be anywhere within the gap. So of an insulator or semiconductor, let's say insulator. So when one has a gap at zero temperature, this corresponds to an insulator. And at t equal to zero, my occupation number, I have some arbitrariness on the position of the Fermi energy. Any position is okay, provided it's within the band gap. This is the band gap. But when I now take the temperature a little bit higher than t equal to zero, then this arbitrariness is not okay anymore. I mean, it's not valid anymore. I have a single place where I can put the Fermi energy. So, however, this is not so when the temperature is different from zero. And the reason is that I must, when I integrate over the density of state times the occupation number, I need to recover the correct number of electrons per unit cell, which is a constant. So when I integrate the epsilon time the density of state times the occupation number, I must obtain the number of electrons per unit cell, which is a constant. And it seems quite clear that if I decide to put my Fermi energy here, very close to the valence, the top of the valence band here, with a Fermi Dirac distribution like this, I will empty state here, but then the excited electron cannot reach the conduction band and they cannot reach any states, and therefore when I integrate the product of this and this, I will not obtain the correct number of electrons. I will obtain less if I put epsilon Fermi here. So from the drawing, one sees that one needs to have the Fermi energy near mid-gap in order to obtain the correct number of electrons. per unit cell when one, okay, let's exaggerate a bit. One needs to be near mid-gap in order to empty the same quantity of state when one occupies in the conduction band. Now, to show it a little bit more precisely, if my K Boltzmann T is much smaller than the band gap, which is always the, which is the case at room temperature, if one has a gap of the order of the dEV, for instance, then I can, if I have this relation that kT is much smaller than the band gap, then I can rewrite my occupation number for the electronic states which are in the conduction band, that is, which have the energy larger than the Fermi energy. I can approximate it as minus epsilon Fermi over kT. So if this is the case, that is the temperature K Boltzmann T is much smaller than the band gap, with the energy being much larger, being larger than the Fermi energy, I can write my occupation in the conduction band as this exponential. Basically, as I mentioned before, the occupation number here tends, when the energy increases, behaves like the exponential, behaves like an exponential, decays exponentially away from the Fermi energy. So the occupation of the electron in the conduction band, this can be approximated as an exponential. It's And similarly, the depletion of the electron in the valence band here, this also goes exponentially to the constant 2 here, or 1, if one doesn't consider the spin degeneracy. So the depletion of electron from the valence band, or the occupation of the holes in the valence band, also behave like have an exponential behavior, that is epsilon f minus epsilon over kT. So this is for energy smaller than the Fermi energy. So with this approximation, or considering that kT is very small, if one has a Fermi energy somewhere here, then the behavior of this function in this region is like this, and the behavior of this function in this region is like this. They both have an exponential decay, and this is the behavior. So this is the occupation of the hole that measures this function, and this is the occupation of the electron that measures this function. And they both behave, have an exponential behavior. So considering this, the only place where one can put the Fermi energy in order to have the same quantity one removes and from the Wilhelm states and that one puts in the conduction state is exactly at mid-gap. Because anything else would produce a very large error in the, I mean, would affect the number of electrons in the unit cell by a quantity that is not negligible, that is not of the order of KT. So, because of this integration here and this constraint that one has to obtain the number of electrons per unit cell, then at final temperature, the only place where one can put the Fermi energy is at the mid-gap. And the error in this case is of the order of KT. The exponential is something extremely, how could I say, it's a very severe decay. So if you differ a little bit from the mid-gap position by something that is larger than the order of the KT here, then you will induce on one of these two sides an imbalance that cannot be compensated on the other one, and cannot be compensated in an exponential way. So one is talking about orders of magnitude when one deviates exponentially of something. So the only place where you can put the Fermi energy is at mid-gap, the final temperature. So basically, coming from finite temperature, when one takes the limit going to zero, one would have the Fermi energy at mid-gap. So for any tiny temperature, your Fermi energy should be at mid-gap, and therefore, okay, at zero temperature, that's also the continuation. That the position will be at mid-gap. All right, so basically the Fermi energy needs to be at mid-gap in order when one switches on the temperature to have a correct number of electrons in the unit cell. So at finite temperature, what will happen in your system is that the valence band edge here will be depleted. There will be some electrons and a finite density of electron missing, and in the conduction band you will have instead the occupation of some state at the bottom of the conduction band. So at finite temperature, the system will behave, the electron in the conduction band will behave like a metal if the gap is not too large. So having put the Fermi energy at mid-gap, now I can calculate the number of the density of the electron in the conduction band, and this will be proportional to exponential the gap over 2kT, and the number of holes or positive carrier in the valence band will be given by the same. So if I replace I mean again, if I go away from the bottom of the conduction band, here this is going to change exponentially fast. So the only place where there will be a significant change in the occupation of the electron will be really very, very close to the bottom of the conduction band. And similarly, for the top of the valence band, the only place where the change will be significant, will be close to the top of the valence band. Anything else decays so fast that it's negligible. Okay, so with the Fermi energy at the mid-gap position, and considering that the relevant energy is this energy here and this energy here, one has this distribution of carrier in the conduction band until the valence band. So these are the intrinsic carrier of a system, an insulator system at finite temperature. So strictly speaking, an insulator that, I mean, a system that is insulating at zero temperature has a finite density of carrier at finite temperature. Now, we are distinguishing insulator and semiconductor by the size of the gap. Basically, from a practical point of view, insulator having a gap above a certain value behave like a T equals zero, whereas semiconductor, which have a smaller gap, actually have a measurable density of carrier at finite temperature, at room temperature. So one distinguishes an insulator from a semiconductor by essentially this condition. If the gap is larger than 2 eV, it's an insulator. And if the gap is smaller than 2 eV. It's a semiconductor. And this is just from a practical point of view. But one can see that a change in the gap from something like 1 eV, that is a semiconductor, to something like 4 eV, that is an insulator, gives a huge difference in the carrier. So if you plug in the number, and if you consider an insulator that has, for instance, a gap of 4 eV, and you evaluate this quantity, that is the density of carrier, you obtain from the exponential, so 4 eV is 4,000 mEV, and KT, I told you, at room temperature is 25 mEV, so 2 KT is 50 mEV. So this is a room temperature, of course, we discussed. From a practical point of view, room temperature is the reference, the interesting reference. So this is essentially equal to exponential of minus 80, which is of the order of 10 to the minus 35. This is the density delta n for the insulator, and let's look at what one would obtain for the semiconductor. So I'm considering a semiconductor with a gap of 1 eV. In this case, my delta N, number of intrinsic carrier, is minus 1000 milliEV, the gap, divided by 2kT, 50 milliEV. And this is going to be exponential of minus 20, which means of the order of 10 to the minus 19. So between my insulator and my semiconductor, the consequence of the gap difference is 26 order of magnitude on the density of carrier. So in one case it's not measurable, it's so small that it's not measurable. In the other case it's instead measurable. So the gap makes a big difference on what one obtains in terms of carrier, intrinsic carrier. And everything comes from this exponential behavior. I mean, it's a severe function, the exponential. If you go away a little bit, the consequence is drastic. So for the semiconductor, the carrier at room temperature are measurable. Instead, for the insulator, basically T equal to zero or room temperature is the same thing. Basically it behaves like there were no carriers. So that makes, from a practical point of view, the difference. And of course semiconductors are interesting from a technological point of view because of this behavior at room temperature, and also because one can dope them, and one can also artificially introduce this way carrier, and those density also depend on the temperature, and one has this way of manipulating the density of carrier also artificially by doping. So semiconductor are very useful materials for technological applications. All right, so I will stop here if you have some questions.